human resource, eh, human resource management ni sangat-sangat penting untuk korang, untuk you all make sure whatever yang you all rancangkan memenuhi, dipenuhi dengan resources yang mencukupi lah, macam tu. Ya. Jadi dalam bab ini kita akan belajar macam mana management in terms of human resource akan berlaku, including hiring, training, compensation and also benefits. So these are the subtopic: hiring and training employees, developing compensation and benefit package, managing employee performance and retention, and also managers and management. Okay, so first of all, bila you dah macam kita punya assignment, okay, so you have to develop a team lah, develop a team consists of 8 to 10 people. Okay, jadi bila dekat sini you dah ada, apa orang kata, you dah ada team lah, okay, you dah ada team. So among the team, identify one among you lah, kan, siapa-siapa lah as a founders. Okay, so awak kena role play lah dekat sini. Seorang kena jadi founders, siapa jadi employees, siapa jadi advisor. Okay, so this of the team yang akan that move a new venture that, from an idea to a fully functioning firm lah. Bila dah ada orang-orang yang berfungsi macam ni, korang akan, you all akan develop a very successful, hopefully lah, kan, ataupun orang kata entrepreneurial team. So usually the team doesn't come together all at once. Biasanya tak adalah datang sekali, kan, sebab kita nak dapatkan human resource yang tepat tu mengambil masa. But it is built as a new firm can afford to hire additional personnel. Kalau you ada duit, you ada, yelah, kalau you tak cukup capacity tapi you memerlukan, you have to invest lah. Advisable untuk you invest on additional personnel lah. Maksudnya you boleh hire orang untuk buat kerja yang sepatutnya yang you rasa you tak sempat nak buat tu. So yang tu lah, you kena ambil team. So bila ambil team, team ni dia akan memberi impact lah, a few impact. Salah satu yang positive impact adalah tadilah kerja itu, the work will be done, but it also involve more than duit yang sepatutnya lah. So dia akan involve paid employees. Dan bila company tu dah makin besar, kita memerlukan consultant dan advisor juga untuk memikirkan lah. Kadang-kadang owner ataupun founder tu dia tak sempat nak fikir, jadi dia memerlukan orang yang lebih expert untuk tolong fikirkan kat dia. Yang tu pun kita panggil advisor dan juga director and professionals yang dalam bidang, so that they can memberi input lagi, memberi advice, memberi training untuk the enterprise tu untuk grow bigger. Jadi benda-benda macam ni you kena consider lah. Maksudnya you kena ada perancangan. So dekat human resource punya business plan nanti, korang kena masukkan ni perancangan. Okay, perancangan in terms of human resource. Jangan, biasa student kan dia buat macam ni tau. Okay, yang ni jadi founder, yang ni jadi manager apa, ni marketing manager, ni operation manager. Itu je. Lepas tu dia letaklah gambar ni, lepas tu dengan degree apa, kan, gaji berapa. Biasa student buat macam tu sahaja. Yang tu diperlukan juga. Tapi yang tu make it simple je. Tak perlu sampai setiap satu page tu seorang. You buat team je senang. Satu page tu you buat team. Lepas tu buatlah, make it creative, kan. Satu page ke dua page sahaja cukup untuk describe your team. Lepas tu you kena ada, dekat human resource tu belakang tu you kena ada, lepas you describe the team tu you kena ada perancangan. Perancangan untuk mengembangkan dalam masa 5 tahun. Contoh, you kena buat okay, human resource satu, year one, berapa orang, year two, berapa orang, year three, berapa orang. Kenapa you nak year three ni, kan? Kenapa you nak year three ni kamu naikkan? Mungkin kamu ada tambah cawangan ke? Macam tu. Alright? So, buat betul-betul plan lah. Betul-betul plan yang ni. Bukan asal keusahawanan ni, eh? Memang betul-betul plan yang visible. Alright? Okay, so bila melibatkan... macam saya cakap tadi lah, bila melibatkan team, dia akan juga melibatkan liabilities. Sebab you kena bayar. You kena bayar gaji orang tu. So, new venture have a high propensity to fail. The high failure rate is due in part to liabilities of newness, which refers to the fact that new company often falter because the people involved can't adjust fast enough to their new roles, and because the firm lack a track record of success. Sebab bila new enterprise ni, dia masih baru kan, dia macam baru belajar. Jadi memang memerlukan, dan kita pula bila business ni memang uncertainty lah. Kita tak tahu apa yang akan berlaku. Jadi kalau you lambat buat keputusan dan sebagainya, maka you akan ketinggalan dan fail lah. Okay, so you have, so cara dia adalah assembly a talent lah. You cari orang-orang yang you rasa tak boleh buat, so you hire orang yang lain lah. Assembly a talented and experienced management team is one path that firm can take to overcome this limitation. Kalau tak, dia akan tak boleh nak grow sangat. Okay, so this is the separate elements of a new venture team. Okay, so nampak founder or founders of a venture. Dia janganlah letakkan 10 orang tu semua jadi founders. Korang letakkan juga siapa employee, board of director, lenders and investor, board of, ni tak? Yang ni, lender and investor ni pun boleh jugalah. Cuma dia ni, function dia nanti tak adalah kerja sangat, dia bagi duit je lah kan. So, bolehlah masuk investor, management team, siapa yang akan lead, promotion, siapa akan lead sales, siapa akan lead marketing, siapa akan lead operation, bagi ni seorang satu ni. And then board of advisor, board of director. So semua ni, you ambil benda ni nanti, make sure you akan ada people yang lead this one. Akan ada ya. So yang ni masukkan dalam you punya business plan. Okay, apa fungsi the founder ataupun founders? Okay, founders ni, the characteristic of the founders of a firm and their early decision have a significant impact on the manner in which the new venture team stage. Apa saja decision daripada founder sangat memberi impact. Dia nak duit, dia nak invest dekat A, dia tak nak invest dekat B, akan memberi kesan. So, size of the founding team, studies have shown that 50% to 70% of all new venture are started by more than one individual. Maksudnya less than 50 ataupun less than dalam 30% macam tu je perkongsian. Yang lain tu semua start by individu. Expert disagree about whether new venture started by a team have advantage over those started by entrepreneur. So tak ada research pun mengatakan partnership lebih bagus daripada perseorangan. Dia tak ada signifikan ni lah. So, apa yang kita boleh buat adalah doesn't matter lah, you nak buat seorang ke, you nak jadi founder seorang, yang lain jadi pekerja, ataupun you rasa you nak buat you nak buat perkongsian terus pun boleh. Tak ada masalah. Sebab no, dia ada cara-cara lah. Kalau you kerja seorang, mungkin you boleh hire orang lain lepas daripada tu. Kalau you partnership, mungkin you boleh gunakan, okay, this partner akan buat benda ni, this partner akan buat benda ni. Okay, siapa yang nak masuk tadi? Right? So, advantage and disadvantage of starting a venture as a team. If you have a very talented team, dia akan memberikan, the teams will bring more talent, more resources and ideas to a new venture. where teams bring a broader and deeper network of social and professional contact to a new business. Yalah kan, bila you ada team you ni, kadang-kadang pekerja ni pun dia berminat dengan you, dia dah kerja, jadi dia akan ada fall in love dengan barang-barang produk company. So tak mustahil lah dia juga akan turut mengoffer ataupun promote lah you punya barang tadi kepada networking dia pula. So the more people, the merrier lah orang kata kan. So the psychological support that the co-founder of a business can offer one another can be an important element of a new venture success. Sama juga ni, bila dua tiga orang, so kita punya circle tu akan bertambah lah. Okay, disadvantage pula kalau berkongsi ataupun dalam team ni, ini banyak berlaku bila berkongsi, bila mana tak boleh nak get along. Dia gaduh adalah bila satu masa tu, masa-masa susah okey. Bila dah senang ke, masa susah sangat ke kan, along the way tu gaduh dah apa, tu pun masalah. Okey. So team members may not get along. If two or more people start a firm as equal, conflict can arise when the firm need to establish a formal structure and designate one person as a CEO. Ni pun sama. Contoh bila you start buat tiga orang ke dua orang, bila last tu, bila kita nak grow, kita kena ada seorang CEO. So nak lantik siapa CEO? Kan, itu pun akan ada konflik lah, tapi ada cara dia. Okay, if the founder has similar area of expertise, they may duplicate rather than complement one another. Ni pun sama. Bila CA ni, contoh dia engineering, kawan ni pun engineering juga. Jadi, the ideas may be duplicate lah. Itu pun masalah juga. Sebab tu kena jaga hati. Benda-benda yang the attribute yang kita, yang you kena tetapkan adalah jujur dan sebagainya. Okay, team members can easily disagree in terms of work habit, tolerance of risk, level of passion for the business, ideas on how the business should be run and similar key issue. Ini pun sama. Bila ada seorang kan, ada kita rasa kita je buat kerja, orang lain tu tak buat kerja, tak geram juga. Tu pun bermasalah, ya. Can create the disadvantages of starting a venture as a team. Okay. But we have cara dia lah, sebabnya bukan kita je kan yang baru buka bisnes ni. Ramai dah buka. Jadi jadi banyak successful attribute yang kita boleh belajar daripada orang lain, ya. Okay. Alright. So this is the key element of successful founding team. Yang pertama, heterogeneous rather than homogeneous team. Itu yang maksud saya kalau dalam team tu korang cari, okay, siapa yang macam banyak pencakap tu, bagi dia sales ke marketing ke. Ada orang yang macam dia memang suka sangat komputer, bagi dia technical ataupun operation ke apalah. Ada orang yang macam dia suka buat kerja je, bagi dia operation. Okay, so ada orang macam, sebab tu bila dalam resume kita letakkan bidang masing-masing. So that bila kita ada heterogeneous team ni, dia akan lebih efektif. Sebab orang tu dia master dalam A, so orang B akan master dalam B, orang C akan masuk dalam C. So bila digabung together, so it will improve the performance of the company lah. Alright. So this team is starting an educational software. Ini contoh lah. Contoh kalau ada educational software. So woman on the left is a former teacher. Nampak tak? Dia jadi ilmu pasal subjek tu memang woman ni expert. Okay. The woman in the middle is a software engineer. So, dia akan faham. Okay, daripada ilmu ni macam mana nak sampaikan. And the man on the right has a business background. Jadi, bagaimana yang man tadi, dia tahu dah ilmu tadi nak jual macam mana. So, dia buat modul, dia buat software, educational software, dan akhirnya dia orang boleh buat business on software tersebut. Itu je lah. Korang pun boleh boleh ambil idea macam-macam. Okay, prefer attribute of sole entrepreneurs and members of a new venture team. Yang ni prefer attribute. Bila you nak buat company tu, preferably you cari orang-orang macam ni. Satu, higher education. Higher education. Kenapa? Nak cari team tu, kena cari orang yang ada higher education. Sebab, evidence suggests that important entrepreneurial skills are enhanced through higher education. Bila you ada ilmu, kan? Bila you ada pendidikan tinggi ni, macam universiti, so you akan ada ilmu yang banyak. Dan kebolehan untuk kamu menyelesaikan masalah. Itu bukan semua orang yang dapat, especially kalau budak-budak universiti, kemahiran menyelesaikan masalah tu sangat-sangat important. Bila you pergi kat kampung-kampung contohlah, ataupun you bercakaplah dengan adik-adik you yang darjah 2, yang form 4, bila satu-satu masalah tu berlaku, you akan nampak siapa yang akan bagi solution yang lebih bagus. Ialah orang yang biasanya ada higher education lah, macam tu. Okay? So, you cari higher education punya people. And yang bagus sekali kalau dia ada entrepreneurial experience. Sebab tu, kalau you all ni nak promote sikit lah. Sebab tu, UMK punya student memang high graduate employability. Because you already have the entrepreneurial experience. Dalam banyak subjek kan? So, founders with familiar dengan entrepreneurial process ni are more likely to avoid costly mistake. Then founders without similar experience. Kadang-kadang kita ada experience pasal knowledge tu tapi tak ada experience pasal entrepreneurial ni. Jadi kita macam main je. Main je. Kita nak buat kolam ikan. Beli je. Beli. Dia tak kira dah tau apa yang mistake, costly mistake yang akan berlaku. Tapi kalau you have the entrepreneurial experience, korang akan kira terus. Okay, sebelum nak buat harga ni, kita kena kira dulu harga kos. Harga kos ni, ni apa yang terlibat. Ramai student, dia buat suka hati dia je. Jual, contoh dia jual biskut 50 sen, spaghetti RM3. Lepas tu, sebab you tak kira apa resources, apa yang you korang kena bayar nanti. Untuk betul-betul, and then berapa you punya ROI. Bukanlah buat kerja ni apa sebagai fisabilillah. Selama-lamanya kan. Jadi, you kena fikirkan begitu. Okay. Kena berapa ROI. Tu ada pengiraan-pengiraan dia. Okay. Relevant industry experience lagi bagus. Kalau dia ada 10 tahun, 20 tahun relevant industry experience. Because daripada situ dia boleh, dia ada better established. Founder with relevant industry experience are more likely to have better established professional network, more applicable marketing and management skill. Okay, so they have already the experiences, so they can embark in this new adventure. Then dia orang boleh nampak what ada apa things yang kita boleh buat, apa yang boleh improve the performance dan sebagainya. Okay, and then it's good also to have a team or founder yang ada broad social and professional network. Sebab tu ramai orang hire influencer sebab dia ada broad social network. Sebab kita nak kolam tu, kolam yang kita nak jual barang kita tu, audience yang kita nak jual tu, yelah kita pun kalau ada kawan kita preferable, kita jual dengan kawan, kita beli dengan kawan kan, macam tu lah. So bila you dah ada broad social and professional network tu, it's good lah, it's really good. Because you will have the potential access to additional know-how, capital and also customer reference. Okay, so how to recruit and select picky employees. Okay, how to recruit and select picky employees. Okay, number one, startup varies in terms of how quickly they need to add personnel lah. In some instance, the founder will work alone for a period of time. Terbiasalah buat kerja seorang, lepas tu baru cari orang. In order, in other instances, employee are hired immediately. Macam saya punya coffee shop, saya hire immediately sebab saya tak sempat lah kan. Memang kita buka pun for the purpose yang lain. Okay. A skill profile is a chart that depicts the most important skill that are needed and where skill gap exists in a new firm. Jadi, kita perlu ada skill profile. Contoh kalau kata macam coffee shop, kena ada barista, kena ada kitchen, kena ada front, front desk punya personnel, macam tu. Ya? Jadi, kena ada skill profile tu. Ikut subjek you lah. Ikut you punya enterprise. Macam contoh kan? Contoh ni bagi JPT, Piggywell. Awak letak nama awak lah. Okay, siapa dia? Okay, dia executive set leadership, Jack. Store operation, Peggy. Supply chain management, Cameron. Contoh, marketing and sales, Jill. Nampak tak? This is the skill profile yang you kena buat. Kan? Instead of you letak nama-nama kawan awak tu. Okay, qualification lah, bla bla bla. So, dekat skill profile ni kena ada. Ni markah juga untuk skill profile. Okay. Saya akan follow all these things untuk bagi markah assignment you all. Okay, board of director. Board of director ni, if a new venture organized as a corporation, it is legally required to have a board of directors. Okay, a board of director is a panel of individual who are elected by a corporation shareholder to oversee the management of the firm. Ada orang manager kan, tapi sometimes manager tu tak semestinya betul. Untuk satu-satu enterprise yang ada, especially untuk investment yang besar, mereka memerlukan satu, apa orang kata, orang yang boleh memantau lah. Okay, memantau on the decision of the management. Okay, biasanya board of director ni ada shareholder di dalam satu-satu enterprise tu lah. A board is typically made up of both inside directors and outside directors. Ada juga orang dalam dan juga orang luar. Supaya bila board director meeting ni, dia boleh buat keputusan yang tidak bias lah. And inside director is a person who is also an officer of the firm. Contoh CEO, siapa lagi yang ada dalam company tu lah. And outside director is someone who is not employed by the firm. Dia macam dia tidak bekerja di situ. Mungkin dia shareholder ataupun atas pengalamannya, kita lantik dia sebagai board of director. So, kita kena bagi allowance dekat dia. So, bila datang meeting tu, dia boleh memberi solution lah dengan masalah-masalah yang kita hadapi. Okay, formal responsibility of the board. Normally, they have three formal responsibility. Number one, appoint the officer of the firm. Okay, board of director ni yang akan meluluskan dari segi human resource yang kita nak ambil, especially peringkat-peringkat management lah. Contoh CEO, semua tu akan ditentukan dalam mesyuarat board of director. Dia tak boleh macam owner kata nak ambil orang tu, ambil je, tak boleh, sebab dia dah ada board of director, so dia kena meeting. Okay, so three formal responsibility. Number one, appoint the officer of the firm. Number two, declare the dividend. Contoh kan, dah dapat keuntungan berapa. Okay, kita nak bagi berapa ni dekat ahli-ahli kita ni. Declare dividend and also oversee the affair of the corporation. Kena tengoklah apa-apa yang berlaku dalam corporation tersebut. Frequency of meeting and compensation. Normally, board of director ni will meet 3 to 4 times a year. 4 kali je setahun macam tu. New venture are more likely to pay their board members in company stock or ask them to serve on a voluntary basis rather than pay a cash honorarium. Tu yang saya cakap tadi, kena, biasanya orang akan ambil payment lah. Tapi ada juga board of director yang fisabilillah. Okay. Alright, board of director can do what board of director can do to help a startup get off to a good start. Number one, provide guidance. Although a board of directors has formal governance responsibility, it most useful role to provide guidance and support to the firm managers. Number one is lend the legitimacy. Another function of a board of director is to lend legitimacy to a firm. Sebab dia ada banyak pengalaman kan, so dia bagilah apa yang dia orang boleh supply tu. A well-known and respected board members bring instant credibility to a firm. Kalaulah orang tu mahir dan ada contohlah ramai yang macam Because dia dah ada company A, maka bila dia jadi board of director company B, mungkin dia ada resources-resources daripada company A yang dia boleh pinjamkan kepada company B, so that company B boleh grow bigger and faster lah. Okay, so basically board of director ni they have two role, lenders and investor and also other professional. Yang ni mungkin masuk dalam final. Board of advisor. Lepas tu, selain pada board of director, kita ada juga board of advisor. A board of advisor is a panel of experts who are asked by a firm manager to provide counsel and advice on a on an ongoing basis. Ya, ni advisor. Dia yang akan menasihat dengan kapasiti dia selama ni, dengan kemahiran, kepakaran dia selama ni, dia boleh advise. Unlike a board of director, an advisory board possesses no legal responsibility for the firm and give non-binding binding advice. Kalau advisory board ni dia tak ada responsibility lah nak melantik ke, dia hanya advice untuk perjalanan firm sahaja. An advisory board can be established for general purpose or can be set up to address a specific issue or need lah. Kalau tiba-tiba ada benda yang berlaku kan yang memerlukan kepakaran, consultancy daripada dua, maka dia akan refer kepada board of advisor. So many people are more willing to serve on a company board of advisor than its board of director because it requires less time and there is no potential legal liability involved. Sama jugalah, dia tak perlu nak sign ke nak apa. Kalau board of director ni akan mungkin ada kemungkinan sekiranya keputusan yang dibuat itu salah ke apa, so dia akan disalahkan. So, like the members of board of director, the member of company's board of advisor provide guidance and lend credibility to the firm. Sama juga eh. Okay, board of advisor, guideline dia, advisor will become disillusioned if they don't play a meaningful role in the firm development and growth. A firm should look for board member who are compatible and complement one another in terms of experience and expertise. When inviting people to serve on its board of advisor, a company should carefully spell out to the individual involve the rules in terms of access to confidential information. So jadi kena bagi tahulah, kena bagi tahu ini company punya rules kan, apa yang perlu didedahkan, apa yang tidak perlu didedahkan. Okay, investor ni dia have to invest interest in the company lah, causing them to become more involved in helping the firm defund. Normally, lenders and investor ni dia akan ada interest yang lebih kepada company tu sebab dia dah keluarkan money. Yeah? So, like the other non-employee member of firm new venture team, lenders or investor help new firm by providing guidance and lending advice. In addition, a firm lenders and investor assume the natural role of providing financial oversight. Normally, dia akan lebih kepada financial oversight lah. Right. This is the function of the investor or lenders. Okay, number one, help identify and recruit key management personnel. Number two, help the venture fine-tune its business model. Business model tu normally akan dikenapasti ataupun disuggest ataupun di-approve oleh lenders or investor lah. Okay. Provide introduction to additional sources of capital. Provide insight into the market that the new venture plans to enter. Serve as a sounding board for new ideas. Serve on the new ventures board of directors or board of advisor. Jadi, this is the things lah. Okay, and then recruit customer. Dia juga yang membawa customer tu. Normally, existing customer lah to the new enterprise. Serve on the board of director or board of advisor. Normally, dia punya function tu lebih daripada directors and advisor lah. Sebab kalau apa-apa dia boleh, power dia besar kan. Kalau dia tak support, dia akan tarik investment dia. Help to arrange business partnership and provide a sense of stability and calm. Normally, investor ni dia akan make sure satu-satu company tu maju lah sebab duit dia kat situ kan. So, dia akan help to arrange business partnership. Okay. Next is other professional. Other professional ni is the that make up a firm new venture team include attorney, accountant and business consultant. Ni yang korang ada nanti bendahari, ada ada peguam, bukan benar accountant, ada pegawai account, ada peguam, ada consultant, ada macam-macam lah, kan? As the company grow bigger, all the professional tu you have to put in lah inside. Okay, business consultant. Business consultant is an individual who give professional or expert advice. Business consultant fall into two categories: paid consultant and consultant who are available for free or at a reduced rate through a non-profit or governmental agency. Business consultant yang paling murah mungkin boleh dapat daripada universiti lah. Lecturer-lecturer memang biasa apa ready untuk buat sebagai business consultant. Alright, so managers and managing. Okay, ada orang kata lah, ni Timos lah. Ingat kan, Timos model hari tu kita dah belajar. Timos kata, the great entrepreneur must in fact be compact in life, the male Apis mellifera. He accomplishes his act of conception at the price of his own extinction. Apa benda yang dia bebe-bebe tu? Nah, nanti kita akan kupas. So, kupas in terms of entrepreneurial manager. Entrepreneurial manager. Okay. So, this is the basic things lah yang when we talk, we want to talk about management. There are a few key concept yang you kena highlight. Yang pertama, perkataan-perkataan yang ada lah, organisation. Jadi kalau contoh ada soalan tanya, what are the key concept, management key concept that you ataupun kata list the management key concept and define and describe the management key concept. So you boleh pilih lah a few terms yang ada kat sini dan you boleh highlight dan describe lah. Okay, one of it adalah organisation. Apa dia organisation? Bila cerita pasal management ni, normally memang kita manage an organisation. So organisation is a people working together and coordinate their action to achieve specific goals. Maksudnya dia bekerja kan dalam satu-satu tempat tu, dia bekerja bersama and dia ada specific goals yang perlu dicapai. Okay, specific goals. So, kalau ada goals, ada orang, ada proses, maka itu adalah organization. Faham eh? So, people, ada proses dia, ada goals yang nak dicapai, itu organization. So, apa dia goals? Goals is a desire future condition that the organization seeks to achieve. Goal ni adalah something yang satu-satu organisasi itu ingin capai. Nak capai apa? Nak dapatkan apa? Itu adalah goal. Goal ni dia ada banyak, ada objektif. Jadi you kena tengok juga. Ada long term goals, ada short term goals. Jadi tu pun kena ni. Management. Management pula apa? Management is the process of using organizational resources to achieve the organizational goals. By, macam mana nak capai? Management ni adalah satu proses. Bukan people, bukan something to achieve. It's a process. So, bila kita selepas management adalah satu proses. So, proses di mana satu-satu organisasi tu menggunakan sumber yang dia ada untuk mencapai impian dia. Okay, mencapai inilah keperluan yang dia nak dicapai lah. So, how to have a very good management? How to have a very good management? Number one, they have to plan. Okay, this is the process yang involved dalam management lah. Planning, organizing, leading and controlling. Okay, planning, organizing, leading and controlling. Okay, resources. Apa maksud? Tadi kita katakan dia adalah satu proses menggunakan resources yang ada untuk mencapai goals. Itu management, kan? So, apa dia resources? Resources adalah organizational asset. Dia ada tangible asset, ada intangible asset. Asset yang nampak, asset yang tak nampak. Itu adalah resources. Jadi contoh dia people, machinery, raw material, information, skill, financial capital. Managers are the people. This is the management yang akan involve dalam management. Satu lagi istilah adalah managers. Tadi management, now managers. Managers are the people. Kalau management is the process. Managers are the people. People, orang. People who are responsible for supervising the use of organization resources to meet its goal. Function dia sama. Okay? Semua dia menggunakan resources, menggunakan sumber organisasi yang ada untuk mencapai goals. Siapa yang buat? Managers. Apa dia proses apa yang dilalui adalah management. Gitu. Ya? Ya, bezakan managers and management. Saya rasa macam nak buat je soalan ni. Sekejap lah, nak catat dulu. Managers and management. Okay. Baca ya. Okay. So, organization must provide a good or service desire by its customer. Apa dia punya aim tu adalah to achieve high performance lah. So, ada banyak istilah atau banyak step lah yang boleh dibuat ya. Okay. David Johnson of Campbell Soup. Tahu tak Campbell Soup tu kan? Lain dalam tin tu, Campbell tu. Dia manage, ni contoh usahawan lah, David Johnson nama dia. Produk Campbell Soup tu. Manage his firm to provide quality food product. So, you tengok eh. You tengok, apa dia punya goals. Goals dia adalah quality food product. Okay, quality food product. Ni, cuba tengok. Physician, nurses and healthcare administrators seek to provide healing from sickness. Okay, nampak? Goal untuk physician, nurse and health administrator tu, dia provide healing from sickness. Macam budak-budak wellness lah. Wellness, you ada company product wellness tu. You cuba cari produk you yang dia punya aim, dia punya goal adalah to provide healing from sickness. Okay. McDonald's. McDonald's, okay, dia punya aim, provide burger, fries and shake that people want to buy. Nampak? Ni resources dia lah, burger, fries, shake. Okay. So, nak siapa? Yang people want to buy. So, in order to achieve high performance bagi satu-satu manager, an organization tu must provide a good or service desire by its customer. Nampak? Quality, healing, people want to buy. That's the positive activity or positive services yang perlu dibuat ataupun di clear ataupun di provide lah oleh organisation in terms of diorang punya management oleh managers. Okay. Organisational performance. Ni topik ni sangat penting. Tajuk PhD saya. Okay. Organisational performance. Satu-satu company, macam mana kita nak measure the managers and management is really good adalah melalui organisational performance. So, how we measure the organizational performance, kita measure on how efficiently and effectively managers use the resources to satisfy customer and achieve the goals. Ada a few perkataan yang you akan guna untuk define the organizational performance. Yang pertama, efficiency. Efficiency is a measure of how well resources are used to achieve a goal. Usually, manager must try to minimize the input of resources to attain the same goal. Efficient tu kita nak kurangkan cost. Kita nak kurangkan cost lah. Macam mana contoh, katakanlah kita guna orang, kita kena keluarkan RM5,000 untuk dapat hasil RM10,000. Okay? Tapi kalau kita guna mesin, kita hanya guna RM2,500 untuk hasilkan RM10,000. So, that is efficient. Maksudnya, kita minimaskan the input of resources tadi untuk dapatkan goal sama. Itulah yang biasa kita guna mesin lah antara kalau nanti ada soalan tanya macam mana kita nak improve kat efficiency. Normally, kita guna digitalization, kita guna mesin. kita gunakan teknologi dan sebagainya. Yang kedua, kita boleh measure the effectiveness. Efektif. Tadi efficient tau. Ni efektif. Effectiveness tu a measure of the appropriateness of the goals chosen. Are these the right goals? And the degree to which they are achieved. So, organization are more effective when managers choose the correct goals and then achieve them. Efektif tu maksudnya, contohlah, katakanlah, you nak buat apa? Katakanlah kita nak capai in terms of effectiveness tu, dia appropriate untuk benda tu. Contoh katakanlah kita nak pergi Kuala Lumpur, nak hantar barang nak hantar barang produk you ni ke Kuala Lumpur. Nak hantar 2 kilogram. Adakah kita perlu lori atau kita perlu hantar ke GNT? Lori company lah maksud saya. Atau kita pergi ke GNT. 2 kilogram sahaja. Which one effective? GNT. Because dia appropriate untuk goals tu kan. Kalau kita nak hantar dalam 2 ton. 2 ton. Perlu tak kita pergi GNT? Tak. Kita hire. Tak boleh lah kan. Kita sama ada kita hire lori ataupun kita guna lori kita ada lah. Kalau kita tak ada, kita kena hire lori. Sewa bukan hire. Okay. Sewa lori. Sebab it is more appropriate to use that one rather than another decision. Kan? So, itu kita panggil effectiveness. So, dia punya keyword adalah appropriate. Okay? Appropriate. Okay. So, okay. And then, kita nak tengok managerial function. Okay? Contoh kita ambil Henry Fayol ni. Henry Fayol tu was the first to describe the four managerial function. Tadi saya awal-awal tadi saya dah bagi tahu kan, management tu, okay, dia akan melibatkan proses. Proses apa? Proses planning, organizing, leading and controlling. Yang ni was determined by Henry Fayol. Dia yang apa tu orang panggil jumpalah konon-konon benda ni. This is the framework lah untuk improve the managerial function. Henry Fayol ni dia kata dia dulu kerja dekat sebagai CEO lah of a large mining company in the latest pada tahun 1800. So dia kata managers at all levels operating in a for profit or not for profit organization must perform each of the function of planning, organizing, leading, controlling. Jadi whatever jawatan you dalam satu-satu company tadi, kan? So, semua orang kena guna empat ni. Planning, organizing, leading, controlling. Whatever lah peranan you. You manager ke, you marketing manager ke, you operation manager ke, you kerani ke. Semua kena plan, organize, leading and also controlling. Okay? So, there are four ni. Nanti kalau kita tanya, for managerial function. Okay, this is the answer. Saya nak tanya lah. For managerial function. Banyak ni saya nak tanya ni. Kita kena buat soalan final. Okay. So, this is the form function of management. Korang boleh jawab writing atau korang boleh jawab dengan menggunakan diagram ni. Okay. So, for function of management ni, dia ada planning yang pertama. Kita choose goal. Function yang pertama ada planning. Maksudnya kita plan dulu. Kita nak capai apa ni? Choose goal. Nombor dua, organize. Organizing, which is we working together to achieve the goal. And then we leading. Leading ni dengan guideline dan sebagainya. And then kita kena control. Control ni monitor and measure lah. Kita dapat capai ke tak goal ni, efficient ke tak, efektif ke tak. Okay, so that's the function of management lah. For function of management, tulis kat tepi tu you all. Okay, for function of management, planning, organizing, leading and controlling. Tulis lah, semua orang tulis, saya nak tengok jap. Okay, planning. Planning is the process used by managers to identify and select appropriate goals and courses of action for an organization. So, there are three steps to good planning. Number one, this is a question yang you all akan selalu tanya. Siapa-siapa yang jadi manager tu, yang ni you kena tanya. Okay, in terms of planning. which goal should be pursued? Goals ni banyak. Kita kan berangan nak capai tu, nak capai ni kan. Tapi which goal yang kita nak sambung, yang kita nak achieve dalam waktu terdekat ni. Which goal should be pursued? Nombor dua, how should the goal be attained? How should the goal be attained? Macam mana kita nak capai tu? How should resources be allocated? Bagaimana resources kita, sumber-sumber yang kita ada ni, kita nak guna untuk capai the goals. Okay? So, which goal? How should the goal? How should resources? Okay? Goals, how and also resources. So, the planning function determine how effective and efficient the organization is and determine the strategy of the organization. Okay, now organizing. Dah kita plan, dah tahu dah nak capai apa. Contoh misi nak kurus, contohlah. Dalam ni, contoh kita nak capai 1 juta dalam masa 3 bulan. So, kita organize. In organizing, managers create the structure of working relationship. Ni. Okay, fungsi manager, dia create the structure of working relationship between organizational members that best allow them to work together and achieve goal. Itu yang biasa kalau dekat company, dia akan panggil task force. Dia panggil task force. Okay, what ada ni? Sebab tu kan ada orang yang macam tak mahir, tak payah nak rasa hati sangat lah. You akan ada goal you lain. Ini semua benda you nak buat, tak boleh. Ada orang, biasanya CEO tu dia akan tahulah dia nak bagi kat siapa. Katakanlah hak ni, goal dia lebih kepada IT. Normally, IT people akan involve dalam that goal. Tapi orang-orang yang pandai sales tu, dia hold dululah. Contoh macam tu. So, dia akan build a structure of working relationship between organizational members. Okay, and then, yang tu lah saya kata tadi, apa? Task force. Manager will group people into department according to the task perform. Itu yang saya cakap tadi tu, task force tu. Manager will also lay out line of authority and responsibility for members. So, buat lantikan. Okay, you kena buat ini, you kena buat ini. Itulah by project. Project apa yang kita nak? Okay, cari personnel dia. Lepas tu, buat dia punya responsibility for members ataupun task lah. Okay, task. List out the task yang kita nak capai. Nak buat. An organizational structure is the outcome of organizing. This structure coordinate and motivate employees so that they work together to achieve the goal. Okay, kalau katalah nak jual roti, kena adalah personal yang jual roti, yang bakar roti, yang marketing roti. Orang tu je lah yang involve. Yang lain tu tak payah libatkan. Contoh, kalau tidak kita akan dumping unnecessary resources. Kalau kita panggil, okay, setiap satu projek tu semua orang involve, dia akan menyebabkan pembaziran human resource lah. Sebab ada orang yang masuk saja-saja, dia pun tak tahu dia nak buat apa. Tu tak payah. Okay. Lepas tu leading. In leading, managers determine direction, state a clear vision for employees to follow and help employees understand the role they play in attaining goals. Ni, normally kita akan tanya dalam soalan-soalan subjektif lah. Okay, kerja dia, leader ni, biasa kan, saya rasa korang biasa ni, bila buat proposal, korang, okay, siapa yang in charge publicity, siapa yang in charge, technical, siapa yang in charge, hadiah kan, kena ada ketua dia, betul tak? So, the ketua tu is a manager lah. Ketua tu akan determine the direction, state a clear vision for employees to follow, kan? Make sure orang bawah ni tahu nak buat apa. Help employee understand the role they play in attaining goals. Okay. Leadership ni involve a manager using power. So, pada masa ni lah, seorang-seorang leader tu menunjukkan power dia, influence, vision, persuasion and communication skill. The most important adalah communication skill. Kalau tak nanti, you suruh A, orang buat B. That's the thing lah. So, you kena betul-betul understand. That's why bukan semua orang boleh jadi leader yang bagus. Okay, leadership involve a manager using power sebenarnya. Okay, the outcome of the leading function is a high level of motivation and commitment from employees to the organization. Jika you ada leadership yang bagus, maka the outcome adalah you punya staff akan bagi motivation and commitment. Okay, dalam satu-satu organization to achieve the goal. Itu boleh dilihat lah. Seterusnya, controlling. Controlling, in controlling, managers evaluate how well the organisation is achieving its goal and takes corrective action to improve performance. Jadi bila kita dah buat dah tu, kita akan tengok, oh okey, yang mana ni, mana ni kan. Sebab tu kalau you ada entrepreneurial mindset, you akan cepat untuk tackle the problem. Okey, sebab kita boleh control. Sebab you belajar kan dalam risk management, okey, ada risk yang boleh di avoid, ada risk yang boleh dikontrol. Okey? So control, kita macam mana control? Kita control dengan how well the organization is achieve the goals and take corrective action, eh. Ni corrective action to improve performance. Manager will monitor individual, department and the organization to determine if desired performance has been reached. Dia tengoklah. Itu yang kena mesyuarat tu. Okey? Mesyuarat bukan postmortem, mesyuarat progress. Progress. Alright. Okay, managers will monitor, okay, the outcome of the controlling function is the accurate measurement of performance and regulation of efficiency and effectiveness. Okay, jadi kalau, apa tu, outcome of the controlling function ni, kalau kita ada controlling function yang betul, maka dia boleh meningkatkan performance dari segi efficiency dengan effectiveness of the inilah. So macam mana nak control? Kita menggunakan syarat. Macam mana nak control? Kita menggunakan syarat ataupun itulah regulation lah. Regulation. Okay, regulation. Management level. Okay. Organization often have three level of managers. They are the first line managers, middle managers and also top managers. First line managers responsible for day-to-day operation. Ni macam kalau kita supervisor lah. They supervise the people performing the activities required to make the good of service. Middle manager ni, dia supervise first line manager. Maksudnya manager-manager, supervisor-supervisor ada seorang manager. Itu middle manager. They are also responsible to find the best way to use departmental resources to achieve goal. Okay. Top manager pula adalah responsible for the performance of all department. Ni CEO, macam tu. Okay, department and have cross department responsibility. They establish organizational role, goals and monitor middle manager. Contoh dia macam branch manager ke, CEO ke, ni adalah top managers. Okay. This is the three level of management. Non-management, first line managers, middle managers and also top manager. Dia makin top managers ni, dia semakin sikit lah. Tak ramai lah kalau first line manager ni ramai lah. Ramai lah supervisor. Okay. Restructuring. Okay. Ini memang banyak bermasalah. Pernah tak korang dengar bila contoh bila you jadi manager, you akan ada apa tu orang panggil staff yang bermasalah. Salah satu cara untuk kontrol staff yang bermasalah adalah restructure. Ada banyak reason kenapa restructuring berlaku. Okay. Top management have sought methods to restructure their organization and save costs. Salah satu dia memang untuk save costs lah. Okay, ada banyak-banyak cara untuk restructure. Number satu, menggunakan teknik downsizing. Downsizing ni eliminate jobs at all level of management, which is it will improve the improve to higher efficiency and often result in low morale and customer complaint about service. Downsizing ni bila kita eliminate job yang tak perlulah. Contoh bila orang complain kan. Jadi kita pun macam tak perlulah kot position ni. Jadi kita pun ataupun daripada control, daripada complain tu, kita tengok apa yang berlaku. Okey, maksudnya this jawatan ni rasanya macam perlu diimprove. So kita try downsizing kan dia. Empowerment. Contoh, expand the task and responsibility of workers. Contoh, kalau you tengok the workers tu ada talent. Okay, ada talent ataupun the macam contohlah macam kalau dekat universiti ni contohnya ada pusat bahasa. Lepas tu kita nampak, oh maksudnya pusat bahasa ni boleh berkembang, jadikan dia fakulti. Faham? Jadikan dia fakulti. Kalau dia boleh berkembang lagi, jadikan dia college. Berkembang lagi, jadikan dia universiti. Contoh-contohlah, kita besarkan, empowerment kan dia. Expand the task and responsibility of workers. Kat sini peranan dia supervisor lah. Supervisor might be empowered to make some resource allocation decision. Kan? Empowerment tu dari segi size, dari segi power, kita bagi dia kuasa. Kita panggil authority to decide. Okay. Lepas tu kita boleh juga self-manage team lah. Give a group of employees responsibility for supervising their own action. Macam contoh coffee story tu saya buat self-manage team. Maksudnya kita bagi group of employees, pandai-pandai lah korang supervise action korang. So the team can monitor its members and the quality of the work performed. Okay, managerial roles. Okay, roles described by Mintzberg ni. A role is a set of specific tasks a person perform because of the position they hold. Kejap ada tujuh je lagi. Roles are directed inside as well as outside the organisation. Okay. So, basically, there are three broad role categories dalam managerial roles lah. Yang pertama, interpersonal, informational and also decisional. Decide, Interpersonal, information and also decision lah. Interpersonal roles dekat managerial roles in interpersonal roles. Okay, roles manager assume to coordinate and interact with employees and provide direction to the organisation. Kat sini, apa yang berlaku semasa interpersonal roles ni? Yang pertama, kita kena figurehead role. Symbolize the organisation and what it is trying to achieve. Kita figurehead kan? Contoh KPI lah. KPI kita nak capai apa? Okay, kita nak student 5 orang dapat dekan. Macam korang lah. Korang rasa macam, okay, saya nak tahun SEM ni saya nak subjek saya 5 subjek dapat A. Okay, you figurehead the role. You KPI lah, you tetapkan KPI you. Okay, and then tengok pula fungsi dia. Leader role. Okay, so leader role dia akan training, dia akan counselling, dia akan mentor and encourage high employee performance. Tengok. Okay, nak capai ni, okay, macam mana kita nak capai benda ni? Mungkin kita bagi dia training ataupun counselling ataupun kita buatlah apa-apa supaya dia boleh, the employee bawah kita tu boleh mencapai high employee performance lah. Okay, yang ketiga, dalam interpersonal role ni ada license role. License role tu kita link and coordinate people inside and outside the organisation to help achieve goal lah. Sama ada kita gunakan networking ataupun kita gunakan open innovation. Okay, kita boleh guna open innovation which is contohlah you ada kemahiran A dalam company, lepas tu ada kemahiran B kita tak ada. Jadi kita ambil orang luar masuk sekejap ataupun kita hantar kita punya staff tadi ke belajar di tempat orang untuk and then bawa balik. Macam tu kita liaiskan. Tu fungsi-fungsi interpersonal. Ni kalau siapa-siapa yang berminat nak jadi HR manager, korang boleh ni. Kerja korang buat KPI, lepas tu tetap hantar training semua, lepas tu buatlah networking tu. Okay? Okay, fungsi yang kedua, managerial dia adalah informational role. Kan ada tiga fungsi tadi kan? Interpersonal, informational and also decision. Informational roles, dia associate with the task needed to obtain and transmit information for management of the organisation. Jadi information tu, dia adalah, maklumat apa yang kita perlu sampai. Maklumat tu boleh dibuat melalui tiga role lah. Monitor roles, disseminator role and spokesperson role. Monitor ni, kita analyse the information from both the internal and external environment. Tengok dulu. Okay, kita meeting. Okay, apa yang ada? Sekarang, resource apa yang kita ada? Berapa customer yang kita ada? Contoh, you analyse the information. Lepas tu, bila you dah analyse, dah dapat information tu, disseminate the information. Okay, disseminate. Contoh, the information tu daripada top management nak hantar kepada orang bawah. Okay, you disseminate. Disseminate tu sampaikanlah. Okay, So manager transmit the information to influence attitude and behavior of employee. Ikut KPI yang kita nak capai tadi, disseminate. Okay, kita ni nak capai 1 juta dalam 3 bulan contoh. You disseminate the information. And you perlukan orang untuk bercerita lah kan, spokesperson role. Use of information to positively influence the people in and out of the organization respond to it. Inilah, bila kamu pergi dekat HR tu ada orang yang macam, biasanya dia duduk kat depan kan, apa tu yang duduk kat desk, information desk tu. Kat situ banyak information dia, so kita memerlukan spokesperson, orang yang boleh explain. Dia ada banyak ni, spokesperson ni, ada yang duduk kat counter, ada yang top management level. Dia je boleh cerita pasal benda ni. Orang lain tak boleh cerita. Contohlah, itu kita panggil spokesperson. Okay, and then last decision adalah decisional roles. Dia associate with the method manager used to plan strategy and utilize resources to achieve the goal. So, decision role ni dia memainkan 3-4 peranan jugalah. Macam mana kita nak decide? Orang yang pertama nak decide adalah entrepreneur lah. Sebab tu, you kena ada, kalau you rasa you bukan entrepreneur, you make sure you adalah intrapreneur. Sebab you kena memainkan peranan entrepreneurial role ni. Okay? So, manager ni, sebab you all kan degree holder, keluar ni memang akan jadi manager. So, you kena memainkan peranan ni. Okay? So, you buat apa? Dalam entrepreneurial role, you decide. Deciding open new project or program to initiate and invest. And, kalau you rasa macam, rasa projek ni boleh diteruskan, then teruskan. Kalau rasa projek ni macam, membazir, so kita stop. Itu maksud decisional role dari segi entrepreneurial role. Disturbance handler role. Assume responsibility for handling unexpected event or crisis. Kadang-kadang kita dah plan dah begitu begini, tapi sometimes benda tu uncertainty. So, kat sini lah kita kena ada plan B, plan C tu. Yang tu yang you kena decide. Decision role dia pada disturbance handler role. Okay. Resource allocator role. Kat ni pun kena decide. You kena assign resources between function and division. You kena decide budget of lower manager. Nak bagi berapa gaji dan sebagainya. Okay. Negotiation role. Juga dimainkan oleh decisional roles. Manager yang memainkan peranan ni. Dia tak boleh semua manager hantar untuk buat negotiation role. No. Sebab dia akan mungkin keputusan tersebut perlu dibuat pada masa tersebut. Katakanlah korang ni cika-cika punya manager pergi, you dapat projek 5 juta. Mana boleh, you boleh tak? Kalau you punya personal tu, you punya jawatan tu, membolehkan you buat decisional role tahap 5 juta, so you boleh. Tapi ada orang yang dia macam, dia boleh 200 ribu je. So you kena ada negotiate solution between other managers, union, customer or shareholders. Ni kena ada, inilah fungsi orang yang buat negotiation. Okay, managerial skill. Okay, managerial skill pula ada 3. There are 3 skill set that managers need to perform effectively. Ni managerial skill. Okay, managerial skill. Okay, menarik juga untuk dimasukkan dalam exam. There are 3 skill set the managers need to perform effectively. 1. Conceptual skill. 2. Human skill. 3. Technical skill. Conceptual skill, the ability to analyze and diagnose a situation and find the cause and effect. Human skill adalah the ability to understand, alter, lead and control people's behavior. And technical skill adalah the job specific knowledge required to perform a task. Common example include marketing, accounting and manufacturing. Yang ni technical skill ni lebih kepada skill yang orang tak semua orang ada. Maksudnya dia, technically dia je ada. Contoh marketing, accounting and manufacturing. Okay. So all 3 skills are enhanced through formal training, reading and also practice. Okay. So this is the skill type needed by manager. Top management, middle management and also manager bawah ni lah. So you boleh tengok kat sini. Kalau top management, conceptual skill tadi dia tak perlu sangat. But human resource perlu. Technical skill tak perlu sangat. Nampak situ. So kalau ni pun sama. Kalau kat tengah middle management, Dia banyak kat sini juga eh. Human resource ni banyak. Technical banyak kat mana? Dekat orang bawah ni. Sebab dia technical kan. Top management ni dia lebih memikirkan keputusan ni. Decisional skill ni. Okay. Management challenge. Ni yang benda-benda yang bermasalah lah bila kita nak ni kan. Okay. Management challenge. Ini adalah perkara-perkara yang kita perlu hadapi. Satu, increasing number of global organisation lah. Sebab kita nak pergi global ke, nak pergi, kita nak go to the our apa tu very good ataupun very highest performance lah kan. Ada few management challenge yang kita perlu hadapi as a manager. Satu, bila kita nak increase number of global organisation, sebab kita kena ada deal dengan dia dan juga kita kena ada involve rules and regulation from different countries kan. Jadi itu akan melibatkan banyak management challenge lah. Okay, nombor dua, building competitive advantage through superior efficiency, quality, innovation and responsiveness. Sebab contoh kalau innovation kan, this is the first time yang kita nak buat. Jadi dia memang memerlukan competitive advantage yang betul-betul kita boleh capai dengan melalui superior efficiency, quality dan sebagainya. Okay. Increasing performance by remaining ethical managers. Kita challenge dia adalah untuk increasekan performance. Pada masa tersebut, kita masih lagi perlu mengikut rules and regulation management. Sometimes ada rules and regulation management yang tidak support kepada increasing performance. Kan? Itu pun jadi masalah tu yang jadi burn out semualah. Managing an increasingly diverse workforce. Ini pun sama. Okay. And using new technology. Using new technology ni ramailah bermasalah sebab teknologi kan dia sentiasa berkembang. Tu yang dia akan dipanggil disrupt technologies. Disrupt the technologies. Kadang-kadang orang tua kan, dia tak minat lah new technologies ni. Itu pun masalah pada management. Okay. So, this is the reference yang kita dah ni. Alright. So, any question? Sampai situ sahaja untuk bab ini.